The Financial Survival Network, helping you to survive and thrive in the new economy.
This is the Financial Survival Network.
Financial Survival Network is presented to you by Regal Assets. Buy and sell physical gold and silver through your existing retirement plan, 100% tax-free with Regal Assets. If you want to include physical gold or silver in your existing IRA or old 401k, request your free investment kit, which was recently featured in the Forbes and Smart Money Wall Street Journal magazines. Call toll-free 855-678-6620, 855-678-6620, or visit regalassets.com. Starting a new weekly feature, the person I'm going to introduce to you, somebody I've met through various professional affiliations. Her name is Diana Zappa. She has been working with the Daily Bell, one of the foremost libertarian websites in the world, out of Switzerland. She's got an amazing story to tell, and she's wired into everything that I think you want to hear. You want to hear about how libertarianism works. You want to hear about how socialism fails, and you want to hear what you can do about what's happening in the world, how you protect yourself and your family. Diana's been doing that. Diana.
Hi, Kerry. How are you today?
I'm doing good. How are you?
I'm doing fabulous. Thank you for inviting me.
Hey, well, I just thought that when I heard your story and the way that you've gotten into this area of the media, that we needed to do a show together.
Well, I think it's a fantastic idea. I'm very excited to participate.
And it's really great to have you on. You mentioned to me that your father was a silver coin collector and that he had a big impact on your life in that regard. Tell us, what's the story behind that?
Well, yes, my father did collect coins always, and they were always handed over to, I have three siblings, and so our weekly allowance was some sort of a silver coin, save it. He ended up saving it, of course, because, you know, we'd be rushing to the candy store if it was possible. But anyways, the idea that we would receive a silver coin, over the years, he has still saved them, and every time he comes to visit me, he's got a bag full, and I think he just continues to collect them along the way and pass them on, and, you know, his intention is, you know, the same as many from his generation, that he understands and did understand that, you know, the government was debasing the money and that you have to have gold and silver backing your currency. Yeah. You know, he knows that value and he's passed that along.
So this is just another case of the older you get, the smarter your parents get, huh?
Well, I guess that can be part of it. But of course, you know, my own education has made some major changes towards that. And I feel that, you know, the last 5-6 years of my involvement in this industry, my husband is in the mining industry, gold and silver in particular. And I have, you know, been very awakened about what is really happening in the world about currency. And silver, gold has always been money. It's all through history. It's always been money. Government have always tried to debase it. And you know, so here we are in the year of 2012 with, you know, absolutely no gold and silver of any kind in our currency other than what people hold. And people need to understand that it needs to be a part of our everyday lives again.
I couldn't agree with you more. And it's interesting in that your father told you that from a young age, and I guess you're Canadian. And in America, we just kind of shrugged off when they switched the coins in circulation from silver to, as David Morgan calls it, the Johnson slugs, which are a copper nickel cladded coin that has virtually little or no intrinsic value. We just shrugged it off. But I remember the day that I found out about it, my brother came into the kitchen all excitedly and he said, "They're taking the silver out of the coins." And I'm like 5 or 6 years old. And he takes, like, he's got a handful of quarters of the silver ones and he drops them on the floor and they sound really solid. They ring. And then he drops the new ones, the 1965 quarters, and they sounded tinny and hollow and not worth anything, just the sound. And that kind of led me to where I'm at today, where espousing the value of real money and that you need to acquire real money because this paper stuff could be gone in the wink of an eye. So it's kind of interesting that we both wound up in a similar place from similar events in a way.
Mm-hmm. And, you know, just talking about, you know, what the difference of how a coin sounds, I remember that very same discussion, you know, with our family and learning that, you know, that this was going to be a changeover in time. And of course, you didn't, you know, being the age that we were, didn't understand really what that implication meant at the time. And as we've gotten older and learned that a dollar bill is not the value of a silver dollar that it used to be, you know, you just start to understand, you know, start to realize that the industry and the currency situation has radically become in the control of the government, and that the government debasement continues all through time, and they will do whatever it takes to continue to debase it as we move through history. And now we're into a place where it's not going to stop. I mean, or it's, you know, it's the idea to go back to a gold standard is probably not realistic at this point, but I certainly think that if the dollar collapses or if it gets to that point, you're going to see a lot more barter and people are going to use small items. I mean, you know, do not give away your mom's silver. Do not give away any, you know, jewelry, any kind of silver jewelry or gold jewelry. Keep that and keep those in places where if, you know, if things do collapse, you're going to have a bit of a resource to use.
Yeah, I think that's really essential. Actually, I have a friend who runs a check cashing operation, and a major part of his business is buying gold and silver at deeply, steeply discounted prices. And I just say to him, like, why do people sell this? And he says, they need the money. And I guess that's it. They don't view it as money.
Yeah. Well, I think that the barter system will become more and more prevalent in these next few years. We're going to see, and I'm sure people are doing it already. And of course, I mean, you know, money and currency, the value of it is based on whatever two parties deem currency to be. If you're selling bread and I'm cutting hair and we deem that as an exchange, then that's a currency exchange. And I think that, you know, I mean, I think one of the last free markets that really exist in the world today, or one of the only free markets that exist in that sense, is, you know, the drug world.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, I mean, let's be honest, right? I mean, they're out there, they set the price, they do whatever. I mean, there's no regulation on it, which, of course, is another whole conversation.
It's funny you mention that any black market is a free market effectively because it's free of government control, but it's affected by the government's declaring whatever it is illegal so that there's a risk involved, and then the profits derive from the risk that the government imposes on that market. Because, you know, cocaine might sell for $1,000 a pound in Bolivia where there's no enforcement, and it'll sell for whatever the price is in the States here. And the whole differential in that price, it isn't that any value got added to it. It's just that the drug distribution cartel or company is getting rewarded for the risk that they're willing to take of going to jail or getting into a gunfight with other gangs or law enforcement. So it's interesting, though, that all black markets are unregulated. And the pricing there, you have true price discovery, unlike in our legal markets that we have now that are totally rigged and manipulated. As Ed Steer said to me yesterday when I was interviewing him from KC Research, he said, all the markets are a total rig job. Isn't that remarkable?
Yeah, it is. And so people like us are out here, we're trying to educate on a grassroots level, which I think is the key to getting people to realize that this is the reality. And I think that, you know, things are becoming more transparent, but, you know, are people really caring is the, you know, the next, it comes down to a human spirit. And what is it take for people to realize that, you know, they have to get, you know, to a moral level where they understand this is really what's going on, and to make that change and to stand in a place and say, okay, I'm not going to accept this anymore, and let's get moving forward so that we can start to, you know, better our lives.
For sure. And I have a new sponsor called Regal Assets, and the president of Regal Assets, this guy, Tyler Gallagher. I had this exact conversation with him. When are people going to wake up? What are you going to do? When are you going to become aware of how corrupt the system is, that it's stealing from you, that it's draining your wealth away and effectively giving your wealth to the wealthy? And he said, you'll become aware when the system stops working and you have to. That's the majority of the population. They're just not going to do it otherwise, are they?
No. And I would like to think that people are trying to make themselves better on a regular basis. In my life, I work a number of different elements. And of course, finance and economics are and can be some of the most boring discussions that there are for many. But you won't be that bored when you don't have any money.
All of a sudden, they'll be interested, huh?
All of a sudden, there's going to be a major concern there. And I think people are starting to, and this isn't a joke or a laughing matter. I mean, this is, you know, reality is starting to happen, that our dollar is so debased and becoming so valueless. And so why does it cost $5 to buy a loaf of bread? I mean, it's not that it takes anything different to create that, or that, you know, the costs associated with it are different. It's because the dollar is worth less. And so it buys less. And so, I mean, so many people are going to feel that coming up, and many people are already. And so how do you protect yourself? And I think this, you know, brings us back to the earlier conversation, you know, how do you protect yourself from understanding that you have to, you know, saving money, of course, is one way. You know, saving your money is something that not everybody does in our Western environment, but
that's less and less all the time.
Because there's less too, but I guess, you know, it's understanding that you have to live within your means, and living beyond your means is just such a Western philosophy in the last 20, 30 years. And I feel that, you know, we could have lived in our time. I mean, both of us we're baby boomers. And so we've seen all kinds of greatness in America. And I think we're on the tipping point of something a little bit different for the next 20 or 30 years.
Oh, I wholeheartedly agree with you. And when you talk about waking people up, trying to get them to understand, I think your work at the Daily Bell probably instrumental in waking up a lot of people around the world. Just how did you get into that, and how'd you wind up working with the Bell?
Well, it was a partnership that was established. My husband and the directors of the Bell were in business in different projects, mining in particular, and Anthony Weil, who is the founder of the Daily Bell, was looking for different people in marketing. And my background is marketing and project management. And so I said wholeheartedly that I was very interested to be involved. And of course, in communications. And he offered me a position to work, you know, in interview assistant, basically. And that meant, you know, running the interview department at the Bell. And so we targeted lists of, you know, names and different people that we were interested to interview. And then I started the process. I've been working with them for over 4 years now. And it completely has changed my life, my opinion about the world. And it brought some real realizations about why I understand now. I am a bit, I don't like to use the term rebellious too much, but I definitely have some ideas about the world that were answered very clearly when I got and, you know, realized I was a libertarian. And so it took 5 or 6 years to really put this under my belt and realize that this is the direction. And all of a sudden, a lot of answers came into place.
So how long have you been working with the Bell?
Since May, June 2008.
And so we're looking 4 years then, huh?
Mm-hmm. And that was the inception of the interview segment. The Bell itself started with basically the idea that we would take two or three pieces of mainstream media and give a free market analysis and then discussion and opinion, if you will, with a conclusion. And the Bell was incepted, basically went to Switzerland, and it was all started in Switzerland and remains there as an international publication, and had the experience of living there and understanding the, you know, we were saying the last, you know, bastions of freedom, basically Switzerland, although things have changed in their direction the past few years too. But having said that, it was an opportunity to big adventure and coming from Canada and living in Canada. My husband is actually half, his mom is American. And so he grew up in the United States, spent a lot of time there. And so we both off we went and we're very lucky to have that experience and to live abroad, of course, is something that not everybody gets to do, but was a really fun experience to do that.
And the Bell has really grown a lot in the past 4 years. I mean, I call it the Bell, the dailybell.com. It's really grown, hasn't it?
Oh, absolutely. I mean, you know, we started off a number of different targeting. Everybody had sort of their lists and friends and just started to get it out there and then started to market through a couple of different organizations through the United States. And as we started to build with the interviews, I mean, basically, when we speak to people and the interviews, we ask people to, of course, carry it on their site, distribute it to their network, and so on and so on, you know, style of marketing. And that's how it's grown over the years. And of course, we've interviewed numerous geopolitical academics, you know, all kinds of trend forecasters and different, you know, very interesting people. There's a lot of information there. The Bell itself is an education. You could spend years there because they've identified definitions and just different people and pretty much everyone who's come on. I've only had a couple of people that disagreed with a few of the definitions, but primarily it's very well researched. The editors are extremely educated and in the sense of the free markets and understanding the operations of the world, if you will. And it's an amazing publication, in my opinion, and I feel very fortunate to be a part of it.
Yeah, and it's extremely well written. So besides me, who you interviewed, who was your most interesting or fascinating subject on there? Tough question, I know, but somebody must stand out.
When you say, you know, who stands out the most, I mean, David Icke and Jordan Maxwell, who are, you know, real existentialists, I mean, are two of my favorite interviews, even though I guess just because they are not completely all along the lines of the political, economic, you know, topic continually. They have a different story to tell. And of course, I've always enjoyed G. Edward Griffin in our time together. I really enjoyed, I enjoyed The Judge when we spoke because, you know, some of them, we do them in different formats. Sometimes I speak with them and record our conversations and transcribe. Oftentimes they're written. And I've had the opportunity to sort of pick and choose. And I find that, you know, people that I haven't had the chance to meet yet, I like to take the time to actually, you know, make the phone recording and have the opportunity to speak with them. I interviewed Gerald Celente just the other day, and this is the second time that I've interviewed him. And I find Gerald to be an extremely fabulous person. He's come full circle with his career in a sense. I mean, he gets the idea that, you know, that human nature is just what it's all about. And, you know, he's very community driven and very decentralized driven. And I think that this is going back to my own philosophy that, you know, it's got to come, education and change has to come from a real grassroots level on a moral value level. And he is there. And he's a very good speaker. And so just, you know, my most recent with him was very, very entertaining. It hasn't actually been released yet. We're saving it for a September issue.
All right. Well, we're looking forward to that. And you're holding an event in the not too distant future. And I think you said he's going to be there.
That's right. I live in Vancouver in British Columbia. And
I was recently. Great city, by the way. Great city. Yeah. And you're hearing that from a New Yorker, so I'm jaded. So that's a real compliment.
Well, for some people who don't know where it is, Vancouver is about 2-hour drive north of Seattle on the West Coast. And I'm very fortunate to live up in West Van, and we have a forest, and I've got creeks here, and there's bears running around in my yard and deer. And I mean, you might think that it's, you know, the Great White North to a degree, but it is in a sense. But I mean, Vancouver is a thriving, you know, 3 million person metropolis, but there's just so many great areas to live that you can still get away from, you know, the urban environment. But the event that I'm working on is an event called the Seed Event. It's like planting seeds, and the Seed Foundation, Production Foundation, is based in Calgary, and I actually partnered with them this year for this event. And it's an all-day speaking event, and we have an interesting lineup. It's a very mixed lineup, and the reason they decided to take the project was exactly for that reason. So we've got Deepak Chopra as the headliner, and Adam Dreamhealer is also with us, and he is a molecular biologist and doctor. He believes that you can heal yourself in any way, shape, or form by understanding that we are electric, and that your molecules exist within you, of course, and that you bring your mind to that level, and you can heal yourself within any issue that may be of, you know, bothering you. So he's an interesting person. And then we have David Wolf, who is the raw food expert out of Los Angeles, and Gerald Salente from New York, who will be calling himself, his topic is basically the future as we know it. And he calls himself a political atheist. And so he brings a very interesting dynamic to the whole event, because, I mean, this event is about wellness and well-being and understanding where you are at a specific level. And everybody's at different places. And so he's an interesting element. So it's a full-day event. It's 12 hours of back-to-back speakers. We have a marketplace where we have a number of sponsors with very unique products. We're still looking for sponsors if anyone's interested to come on board. And we have an organic cafe, and so it's at the Peony Forum. We're transforming the Peony Forum, and it's going to be a very unique day for the Vancouver group.
It sounds like a great event, and definitely looking forward to it. So people want to find out more about you, Diana, and the event that you're holding, where would they go?
They can find out information at Zoppa Media Group and or theseedevent.org.
All right. Well, hey, sounds great. And we got our first show under our belts. Next week's going to be even better. Diana, we'll talk to you again next week.
That sounds great, Carrie. Thank you.
Thank you.